I want to thank the Academy for allowing me to present this award to the most distinguished actress of this past year. Our tribute goes to someone who is not only a great artist, but to someone whom we all dearly love. A grand old trooper who has carved her niche of fame in two generations. Miss Mary Dressler.
Welcome back to Know Northumberland. We're going to start things off for the second half of our show with Rick Miller from the Mary Dressler Foundation. And so let's talk a little bit about the museum itself and Mary Dressler. What's happening at the museum?
Well, the museum is a tribute to Marie Dressler, and it started out by an idea of refreshing her story for the residents of Coburg and for visitors to Coburg.
Why was it important to refresh basically everyone's memory of this? What was it that sparked this need?
Well, Marie Dressler was born here in Coburg on King Street in what's now called Marie Dressler House. And in 1989, there was a giant fire and the building almost burned to the ground. And some citizens who were concerned about protecting the heritage of Marie Dressler as a citizen, as a native of Coburg, decided to raise money to restore the building and to build a little memorabilia room with pictures and artifacts about Marie's life inside. 25 years later, it was looking like it needed a reboot. It really needed to tell a story about Marie, and it was somewhat static. So that's what was the spark for us to think about, what do we do next? So we don't know how to build a museum. So we looked around and we approached the University of Toronto, which has a master's program in museum studies. And we asked them, can you give us some guidance? And we were just looking for some advice. Instead, the university asked me to come and make a presentation to the class. And after the presentation, five young women from the University of Toronto's Museum Studies master's degree course agreed to design our museum. And over a period of 6 months, as part of their thesis, they built a total design of the museum, including all of the choices we had to make in terms of what it looks like, all of the text that goes into the interactive system, and presented that back to us as a gift from the university to the foundation.
How long did that take?
Well, we started in September of 2014, and we finished in 2015 in April. Their thesis was presented to us. We came to the town council to give them a little bit of an update, so people were interested in what was going on. It took us a year to raise the money to have enough funds to commit to building the museum. And we hired one of the five young ladies as our project manager, and she started on April 1st, 2016. We opened the museum September 2016. So 6 months of intensive work to make it come to fruition.
All right, and that's when it got named the Heritage Museum, correct?
Well,
it's called
Marie Dressler Museum. Mm-hmm. The building was designated as a heritage building back in 1990. But people really didn't know a lot about what was going on inside. So we've kind of re-energized it.
Exactly. You really did refresh things.
We did.
Perfect. We did. So can you tell me a little bit about basically what happened in September and what the plans are going forward now with the museum?
Well, the first big change is that it's a self-guided interactive museum. So it's 21st century technology. So you'll go in there and you'll interact with the iPads. You'll see video clips. There are things you can do. You can learn about Marie. You can go from...
What else can you do?
You can learn about Marie. There's an interesting dressing table mirror where you can go up for selfies and select a portrait of Marie, and there you go. Marie will be displayed on the screen. There I am, showing how it works.
There we go. So there's lots to do.
There is.
Perfect.
And we have some original artifacts, like that gramophone, for example, and the posters. And we have a beautiful collection of framed photographs from our collection that have been reproduced. This painting was done by Heather Cooper, a noted artist here in Northumberland County. And that is the young Marie peeking out the window of the front window as you walk up. And Marie was a young woman when she lived here. Her parents moved away when she was just a teenager. And we wanted to have the young Marie looking out the window as opposed to the Marie that everybody remembers, which is the older version of Marie.
Exactly. The big comedian, basically, is how many will remember her, of course. But then you also have the younger version, which she went into performing arts at such a young age. And I know that's so important to the museum and how you've now become a registered charity.
Yes, we've been a registered charity from the beginning. And one of the things that was important...
Since 1989.
So one of the things that was important to us was to reflect that back into the community with charitable work. So in addition to raising the funds for building the museum, what we wanted to do is create an ongoing event that was linked to Marie's profession, a performing artist, and help the community. So we founded the Vintage Film Festival 25 years ago. This year will be our 25th version. And every fall we run a two-day or three-day, and it's now 3 days, program showing vintage films. And the money that we raise from that goes to pay the overhead of the foundation, but also the profits go towards giving student bursaries. And this past year, in 2016, we gave 4 bursaries of $1,500 each to graduating students from across Northumberland County. This year, in 2017, we will again give 4 bursaries of $1,500 each to graduating students.
Wow, that's incredibly exciting for especially students that are looking at a lot of debt probably down the road. So how can students now go and sign up and try and apply for these bursaries?
The easiest way is to go to our website, and that's www.mariedressler.ca. On there you will see a section about bursaries. When you click through that, you'll get the application form and the instructions. In addition, we representatives of our foundation visit the high schools and speak with the guidance teachers, so they'll be promoting it. And then we'll do some media awareness in the next month or so that they get the applications in.
So applications are out right now.
The deadline is for end of May. We make our decision and we make our awards at the end of June.
So what is the last day someone can apply?
May 31st is the cutoff.
May 31st. And everyone's allowed to apply right now?
Yes, absolutely.
It's all open?
It's open.
Perfect.
It's open.
All right. So we'll actually head now back to the annual film festival. And I know that there's a big connection this year with Canada 150. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Well, we have two things. One is our annual film festival is our 25th anniversary, and that's very special. For anything to kind of continue on for a long period of time is special.
Of course.
But especially for our film festival, because it's a lot of fun for people, but it's also a fundraiser.
No, tradition is so important, especially to a smaller community as well.
Yes. So for our 25th anniversary, we wanted to choose the best films that from among the best films that we've aired in the last 25 years, but we wanted to bring a Canadian focus to it. So one of the guiding principles was every film needs to have either a Canadian actor or a director or a producer. Someone Canadian has to be in the film.
In a bigger role.
Yes. And so if you look at our program, which is now posted on our website, vintagefilmfestival.com, you will see all the films that we present this year. And you'll see names like Leslie Nielsen in his early days, he was in a vintage film. You'll see a film directed by Norma Jewison. You, of course, see our favorite Marie Dressler in a film. You'll see Norma Shearer, Mary Pickford in films. So we've tried to bring the best of early Canadian vintage film participation, Hollywood films, into our festival this year.
What kind of genre will the films be?
It'll be a mix of things. We have some comedies. We have some dramas. So it'll be a fun program. But for Canada 150, in addition to that, we came up with an idea sponsored by the town of Cobourg and our expertise to put it on, of doing a documentary festival about Canada. So April 29th and April 30th, all day, we will be running a documentary festival of a variety of films about Canada in various themes. and that will be held at the Loft, and admission will be free. We will announce how you can get hold of tickets very soon. We're just working through the logistics, but the program's set. You can go on our website. You can look at all of the films that we have selected. These are films from the National Film Board, CBC Archives, etc. And there's some really, really interesting stuff there. And that's our gift to the town of Coburg and the residents for Canada 150, with the generous sponsorship of the town of Coburg Canada 150 committee.
Okay, and I know it's also, this fall would be Murray Dressler's birthday, 150th, correct?
Well, we're almost there. November 9th is her birthday. Next year, 2018 is her 150th birthday.
I was a year off.
Well, you're close. There's always controversy when you ask a woman her age. And in the birthday clip that we showed, the newspapers said it was her 62nd birthday, but it was her 65th birthday because Marie sort of shaved a couple years off.
But next year's
150th anniversary. We're still looking for her Academy Award. It's been lost in the shuffle somewhere. So we're hoping this time next year for her birthday, we can do something about that. So
have you?
The hunt is on.
The hunt might be on, but do you have any feelers out there basically as to where it could be?
Well, we do. But the trail has gone cold, so we have to resurrect that, and maybe the Academy will help us out with that search. We'll see.
There you go.
We'll see.
And so what does the museum have coming up basically that is big and exciting for 2017?
Well, for 2017, our program's fairly current because we just designed it. We only implemented it in September. Mm-hmm. And of course, it's organized in different modules and themes about her life. So her days helping the war effort, her work with women, those are all special themes where we have lots of content in there. Any museum needs to refresh itself occasionally. So in 2018, in particular, not 2017, we'll be going back to some of those modules and saying, what else do we need to change up? And the great thing about interactive technology is you can update it a lot easier than a conventional museum where you have to take exhibits apart and bring some stuff in. So we'll be sort of focusing for 2018. There's lots of interesting stuff for people to go through in the next year.
Oh, that's great. Well, I guess with this day and age, and obviously technology is making life a lot more simpler, but with pop culture and so many new ideas basically getting put out there, why do you think it is important to kind of stop and take a look back at Murray Dressler's foundation and really take a look at her life, and especially for the new generations growing up, why is it still so important?
Well, it's a couple things. One is the heritage. You know, she's part of our heritage, and so it's important to pass that heritage along to future generations. And that's why it's important for us to do this. The second thing is, Marie Dressler was ahead of her time in many ways in her support for the women's effort. You know, when she was a big star, she was one of the biggest, highest paid stars on Broadway. The chorus girls went on strike because they weren't really getting paid. They were getting something like $8 a week and she was making $2,500 a week. She went and joined their strike effort, and after the strike was settled, she was blacklisted by theater producers for many years. They would not put her in any plays, and so she went from the top of her career down to the bottom because of her desire to support these chorus girls, because that's where she started. Mm-hmm. Her support for the women's effort, you'll see this in one of her films, Politics, where she's plays the role of a woman running for mayor against a sort of shady guy who wants to run for mayor. Her support of the war effort. So here's a woman who persevered through a lot of things. She had a career that went up and then she hit at the bottom, and she finished up on top in her 60s. And you know, she's just a model of hard work, perseverance, and she apparently was a very nice woman. Obviously, we don't get to meet her, but you know, she was one of the best loved actors of her time. And in 1932 and 1933, this 60 plus woman was the highest grossing movie star in Hollywood. And so think of it. This is the era of the young and the beautiful and actors coming through. And here is a woman, as Norma Shearer described her, the old trooper, who was for two generations very popular. And so I think there's lots of good things to celebrate.